Hello students, welcome to one more mini lecture on generation of computers. Generally, most of the books and teachers in colleges also cover this generation of computers almost in the very beginning few classes. But I took a decision to put it a little late so that you can understand it better based on going through a few fundamental concepts of memory, hard disk, okay, all those basics. Once you understand, this generation of computers is going to make much more sense and logic to you. All of you are aware, we live in the age of computers, or we are in the information age. Now, since we are in the information age, okay, we are surrounded by computers from the time we are born. And especially the younger generation, it is logical for you to assume that life and computer technology was always like this. But that is not the case. The computers have evolved over a period of the last 70, 80 years. So it is important for the younger generation to understand how the evolution took place. Okay, what are the changes that took place every 10 or 20 years, and also develop an appreciation of the power of computer technology in today's world compared to maybe 50, 60 or even 70 years back. Now, broadly, we go about classifying computers based on a few factors. The first of them is technological improvement from one decade to the next. Generally, computers which are older will be less slower than the one which are most recent. Also, the size of older machines will be much bigger than the ones of newer machines. The newer ones are obviously going to be more reliable, more effective, more efficient, cheaper, and capable of doing many, many more things than what they were able to do at the beginning. Now, one more important change which has taken place is, in the 50s, when computers were first used by major companies, okay, people at home could not even dream or even think of using computers. Only in the beginning of the 80s, that's when IBM released the personal computer, computers became widespread even at homes. So based on this background, let us look at the evolution of computer technology starting from somewhere around the 1940s till date, and let us see what are the changes that have taken place over the last 70-80 years. The first generation of computers, all right, is roughly given the age from 1940 to 1956. Different authors may use different date range here and there by a year or two, but broadly it falls under this date range. For some of you who have your parents, you can ask them about the huge transistors at home. They were this big, the radios were this big at home, which used to use vacuum tubes. So the first computers were based on vacuum tubes. Vacuum tube is a simple glass tube which has an anode and a cathode. So based on heating the element, there's a flow of electrons, and the flow of charge is used to indicate a positive, that is a 1 or a 0. That was the basic fundamental principle of working of a vacuum tube. For main memory and also some portions of the secondary memory, something called as a magnetic drum was used. You could think of it as a cylinder coated with magnetic material outside, and just like your modern hard disks, you had read-write heads to read data from the magnetic drum. So magnetic drums are nothing but a drum-shaped object in which ferromagnetic material was coated, and the direction or the presence of charge determined 1 or 0, and they formed main memory of the computer. Now, as you will see in the pictures I show you, they were really, really huge. They were maybe filling multiple rooms. What you have in a laptop today probably was holding about 5-6 rooms in those days. Because of their size and because vacuum tubes were very old technology, they consumed a lot of electric power. Because they consumed electric power and they generated heat, there was a lot of generation of heat, and because of the generation of heat, it resulted in the breakdown or regular maintenance problem with the machines. They regularly had breakdowns. Now, at this point of time, other than machine language, there was nothing which was really known or used. If you had to talk to the machine, you had to talk in terms of ones and zeros. So, a very small group of experts actually worked with computers. It handled, for example, only one task at a time. For example, if you're typing a program, it could only accept the program. It couldn't at the same time do a printing or things like that. Now, I will tell you what are punch cards and paper tape. Right now, you have keyboard, but keyboards are quite recent. They have come in the 70s and 80s. Before that, there was something called as punch cards and paper tape. In the next diagram, I'll show you what is a punch card and a paper tape. The earliest machine in this generation was ENIAC, which basically stood for Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer Machines. So this was the first machine of this particular generation. Now, the machine which was really popular was a machine by name called as UNIVAC. Okay, UNIVAC stood for Universal Automatic Computer. The reason it's a landmark machine is this was the very first commercial computer which was bought by the census. That means people would keep track of population in the US in the year 1951. So here, if you see, this is your punch card. So how punch card works is, suppose you have to type A or some numbers, the presence or absence of holes in that particular numbered or labeled position indicates a character. Okay, so simply the presence or absence of a hole or a punch indicates the presence or absence of some data or some character. Now you can understand the challenge with this. If you make one punching mistake, you have to re-punch the card. It was extremely difficult writing code on this. Now this paper tape is also very similar in concept to the punched card, in the sense it also uses holes, the presence or absence of holes, to communicate or talk to the computer. Now let me try to show you the machine ENIAC, ENIAC, as well as the first UNIVAC machine. So if you tend to see here, all right, if you tend to see here, this is the ENIAC machine, which was in Philadelphia, and it was used by the Ballistic Research Laboratory. So you have two people here working, and if you see here, you can see all this wires and vacuum tube circuitry around here. So this is a very simple machine, probably not even as powerful as your half or 10% as powerful as your laptops of today. But this was the size it occupied, required a lot of cooling because of the vacuum tubes generating a lot of heat. This was the UNIVAC machine, which was used by the Census Bureau or the population people. And these are all examples of magnetic tapes where data was stored permanently. This is the console where the operators sat and fed in information through punched cards. All right. So this should give you an idea about the first generation of computers. All right. So this is basically based on vacuum tube technology. Now what we shall do is, let's take a look at the next generation of computers. Okay. The next generation of computers was somewhere around the year 1956, a very small generation, 56 to 63. The major aspect of this particular generation was the involvement or the development of transistors around the 50s, and their popularity helped in replacing vacuum tubes. Transistors were a revolutionary invention. The reason was they consumed less power, they were highly efficient and stable. Okay, so they actually revolutionized the computer industry. So as I said, with the development of transistors, computers became smaller, cheaper, faster, less prone to breakdown, and consumed less power and generated less heat. Now, but still things did not change much, in the sense punched card was used for giving the input, and as well as there was a printed paper or printouts were used for getting the output of the computer. Now here, the major development in terms of what we are really interested is the development of the assembly language. In place of ones and zeros, we use symbols to communicate to the computer, and these symbols are known as mnemonics, which I have already spoken to you. Languages like Fortran, COBOL, okay, ALGOL, these were active development and also being used in different places. Now, the instructions and data were being stored not on your magnetic drum now. They were being stored in something called as a magnetic core. Magnetic cores were used for almost 20 years between 55 to 75. I'll just show you a small diagram of a magnetic core and I'll give you a very high level overview of how it works. So this is your magnetic core, had very little memory, 1 kilobyte and so on. Alright, very small, 1 KB, 2 KB and all. So in this magnetic core, the idea of working was simple. At the center of the transformer, there were wires surrounding it. So based on the flow of current, if it flowed clockwise, you could consider it as 1. If the current flowed anti-clockwise, you could consider it as 0. So based on that fundamental principle, this represented the magnetic core. So this magnetic core memory was famous and used for the next 20 years. Now, a very good example of machine developed in that area is the IBM, that is the International Business Machines 1401. So you can see the size has come down considerably in the second generation compared to what was used in the first generation. So in this, I gave you a background about why we have to study the generations, spoke to you about the first and second generation. In the next video, I'm going to talk about the third, fourth and the fifth generation of computer evolution. With that, let's meet in a few minutes again.